Now, it is one of the most prestigious music awards available in Britain. When the winner of this year's Mercury Prize is announced in a few hours' time, it'll recognize what the judges decide is the best album of the year. This year's list, featuring artists ranging from 19-year-old Jake Bugg to 67-year-old David Bowie, has been called the most mainstream ever. But in an age when most playlists are made by the listener, what value does an album still have? Our culture and digital editor, Paul Mason, now reports.
When a rock band says, we're making an album, this is what it used to mean. At the vinyl factory, the remains of a once giant EMI pressing plant, the workforce and production runs are small. This is a niche market for deluxe versions or diehards. The rest of the musical world is digital.
This is what a piece of vinyl looks like before it's pressed into an album. It's actually hot. No, albums only exist because 60 years ago we worked out how to put 12 tracks onto one of these instead of just one. We don't need this technology anymore, so why do we need albums?
Well, first, because traditions die hard. For tonight's Mercury shortlisted artists, the album is released as a kind of flagship for other stuff, like performances, chart singles, videos. But as they strut their stuff, they know the world beyond the recording studio has changed dramatically and fast. In London's Shoreditch, where the internet is the new rock and roll, they monitor our music consumption in real time. They're measuring whose songs are played on Spotify, on SoundCloud, which bands are being liked on Facebook.
Yeah, there's definitely still a place for albums, but there's a huge consumption of tracks now, and places like YouTube, Vevo, Spotify, people make playlists. So what we're seeing is a sort of an album as very, very well curated playlist by the artist, I suppose. But people are making their own playlists on Spotify and similar services and kind of consuming them in the same way that previously people would have consumed albums.
It seems now we're all curators, as hipster beards came in, listening to a whole album at once went out. Mercury shortlisted band Foals are now on their third album, but their social media stats tell a story of instant success not obvious from any chart. A month ago, their fan base spiked tenfold according to these metrics, all driven by traffic on the website SoundCloud.
You see a lot of fans that maybe aren't necessarily a fan of the band, but they like a song. And that happens a lot more now because there's a lot more sharing, it's a lot easier to access music. We see that often an artist will be promoting a song or a track on all the different sources they can because there's not really the concept of an album on these things like YouTube and Vevo, it's just the video or the song.
So, like the motet, the sonata, or the fugue, it may be that the 12-track album's heyday is over. But those who lived through it have a right to feel lucky.
We were still producing Beatles albums. I think Let It Be album was being produced when I started. I personally believe that it's more user-friendly too. It's like just a move that...
You can pick your tracks by moving the stylus.
Yeah, I know you could do it automatically, but it's lovely to see it and you just drop it down where you want it to play. Shafted in a
thousand pieces. Some things, though, are still the same as in the stylus era. We put every song from every album in tonight's awards into a word cloud, and it turns out the old obsessions, with love and loss, loom as large as ever. Stumbling through the sky. Well, joining me now is Yanis Philippakis, lead singer with the band Foals, whose album Holy Fire is nominated for tonight's Mercury Prize. Yanis, congratulations on the album.
Thank you very much.
How important would it be for you to win at this prize?
Not to be disingenuous, but I haven't thought about winning it that much. It's enough in a way just to be nominated, and I'm pretty sure every band feels that way. Just to be nominated is kind of good enough.
You nearly won it in 2010 and you missed it then. I mean, you've been making albums since 2008. I mean, what would it do though? I mean, do you suddenly go stellar? Do you go global if you win something like this?
Well, I think you know as well, like, there's definitely a mixed bag of how the success fares after you win a Mercury Prize, but I feel like we're relatively established. I'd like to think that it would only have a positive effect and that it would do something for us. I think psychologically within the band, we'd feel good about winning it. We'd feel like there was artistic validation there.
Your album, Holy Fire, is traditional in this sense. It has a beginning, a middle and an end. How does it feel to see all that pulled apart and curated by other people on things like Spotify?
I don't know about Spotify element of it, but I like remixes. I like the reinterpretation of our songs, particularly if it's by artists we admire.
Because you dissed Spotify earlier in the week, saying that you'd rather people steal your stuff on vinyl than listen to it. All that. Why?
That was a slightly flippant, hyperbolic comment that was said at the end of an interview. I have problems with the integral system of streaming services. It's not just Spotify, but there's a disparity between what the artist puts in to the product and what he gets out in terms of remuneration. If I work my backside off for a year and making a record, by proxy through Spotify, people will say, I heard about your band through Spotify, I came to your show through Spotify, ticket sales are up, all of that. But within the business model, there's a disparity, there's an unfairness that's inbuilt into the streaming service where artists aren't being financially rewarded for their work.
Yanis Philippakis, thank you very much. Good luck tonight.
Thanks a lot.
Cheers.
Thanks, Paul.
Chris.
They're all winners. It's one of the great lies, isn't it, of life. There's only one winner, and you know what that makes the rest of them. Still to come tonight, that